The people behind Marvel Comics might create superheroes, but they themselves are just people. And normal people are as scummy as Norman Osborn, and as greedy as J. Jonah Jameson, and as devious as Obadiah Stane. This means that Marvel has done some things and published some questionable comic books that they'd rather you just forget altogether. Here's a look at some secrets Marvel doesn't want you to know. Strange practices. Marvel's iffy history of stereotypes and cultural appropriation has been dragged into the spotlight recently thanks to films like Doctor Strange and shows like Iron Fist, both of which take elements of Asian culture and whitewash them by casting Caucasian actors as the heroes. But the directors at Marvel Studios and showrunners at Netflix aren't entirely to blame. It all started in the comics themselves. Take the case of the Ancient One, Doctor Strange's mentor, who in the comics is portrayed as a stereotypical Asian mystic whose magical wisdom helps inform the white hero's journey. The filmmakers recognized this is a pretty dodgy concept, but their solution was to double down by recasting the character as another white person. A more radical idea might have been to cast Doctor Strange as an Asian American character, which is what some scholars and industry veterans believe Doctor Strange co-creator Steve Ditko originally intended. So why did Doctor Strange become white in the first place? The best guess is that the always pragmatic Stan Lee decided fans in the early 60s weren't ready for an Asian lead. The more things change, the more they stay the same. Slap leather. Imagine you know nothing about gay people, and yet you want to publish a comic book about a gay cowboy. What do you do? How about making him as overtly, flamboyantly, stereotypically, cartoonishly gay as possible? That's what Marvel did. Meet the Rawhide Kid, the star of an older Marvel comic about a gunslinger. Years later, the company decided to bring him back and make him as stereotypically and reductively gay as possible. While some actually felt the camp element intentionally inverts and counteracts heteronormative ideologies, try saying that five times fast, most readers just found it to be offensively bad, and better off forgotten. The death of romance. Once upon a time, Marvel published a thriving line of romance comics, but the renewed popularity of superheroes in the 60s killed it off. In the early years of the 21st century, though, Marvel decided to try to bring back the romance comic. So who did they hire to write it? Maybe an author who'd made a name for herself with Harlequin fiction, or possibly someone with experience writing modern romance comics. No, of course not. They hired Mark Millar, better known as the guy behind the comics that inspired the movies Kick-Ass and Wanted. His romance comic was called Trouble, so there was at least some truth in advertising. The two scantily clad lead characters spend most of their time hooking up until one of them accidentally gets pregnant. And you discover she's actually Aunt May. And her baby is Peter Parker. Marville. Once upon a time, Marvel was run by a guy named Bill Gemmis, who was actually in charge when things like Rawhide Kid and Trouble were published. He decided that those comics weren't embarrassing enough, though, so he went ahead and wrote his own comic called Marville. Since its publication in 2002, Marville has gained a reputation as one of the worst comics the company has ever published. It featured everything from randomly gratuitous covers that had nothing to do with the story, to a bizarre, nonsensical discussion on the nature of God, to a clumsy sequence about racism that immediately required a written apology. Gemmis ended the series with a note proudly admitting that Marville has been a story that would never have been published if I didn't happen to have this here job as president of Marvel. Well, at least he got that part right. Toys make the money. Spider-Man is the most profitable superhero in the world, but not from his comics or movies. In 1 year alone, Spider-Man merchandising made Marvel about $1.3 billion. Spidey toys, blankets, shoes, glasses, bug repellent. That's where the real money comes from. That's also why all the various movie franchises are so important to Marvel. Because while films certainly make money, that's not as important as how they increase brand recognition and enable Marvel to sell more licenses of more characters to more brand partners. For instance, 3 years ago, would you have bought a plate with Rocket Raccoon and Groot? No, because you didn't know who they were. Now, you'll buy anything with them on it. That's how Marvel actually makes money. Just like how the movie theaters themselves really earn their cash by selling you overpriced popcorn rather than actual movie tickets. Who knew, right? Civil Disobedience. Ta-Nehisi Coates is an amazing writer, perhaps best known for his work Between the World and Me, about life as a black man in America, which won the National Book Award for Nonfiction. He later won the Genius Grant from the MacArthur Foundation. All of these qualifications help explain why Marvel sought him out to write titles like Black Panther, and why it's so bizarre that Marvel completely ignored his advice not to kill a major black character for no good reason. The character in question was James Rhodey Rhodes, better known as War Machine, who you might also know from the movies. During Marvel's 2016 event, Civil War II, the publisher decided that in order to provide some character development for a couple of other white characters, specifically Captain Marvel and Iron Man, they would kill off Rhodey. Having been around for decades, War Machine is one of the most recognizable black characters in the world of superheroes, and his huge role in the movies proves that he's more than just a fan favorite. He's a massively popular and visible character in his own right. Naturally, Coates urged them not to go through with it, writing a long missive to the Marvel bosses. Marvel ignored his advice and killed off Rhodey, resulting in more than a little backlash from fans and critics. And this isn't the first time this has happened, either. Like Goliath in the first Civil War series, Rhodey became yet another victim of superheroing while black. Contract killers. Back when Marvel started out, the late, great Jack Kirby co-created some of Marvel's biggest characters, including the Avengers, X-Men, Fantastic Four, and the Incredible Hulk, just to name only a handful. But there was a tiny problem. Marvel didn't care. Since he was considered work for hire, Kirby got paid by the page, and Marvel kept all the rights and all the profits. Naturally, once Marvel started making literally billions of dollars off his creations, this became a sore spot for Kirby's family, who sued. With a looming PR disaster on their hands, Marvel eventually cut a deal with his estate. Not everyone is so lucky, though. Ghost Rider co-creator Gary Friedrich also sued Marvel over profits from their films. But without the name recognition of the Kirby estate, Marvel felt no need to play nice. The case settled in 2013, but Marvel sure made life tough on the guy. Stay classy, Marvel. Don't be like Ike. Marvel has a secret CEO named Ike Perlmutter. Just how reclusive is this guy? Until recently, the last known photo of him dated to the 1980s, with one website going so far as to have his friends describe him so they could draw an approximation of what he might theoretically look like. He's basically like a supervillain hiding inside a volcano lair.
Here's the plan. We get the warhead, and we hold the world ransom for $1 million.
What we do know about Perlmutter is that he apparently doesn't like female superheroes very much. A while back, the infamous Sony hack revealed a bunch of secret emails between Sony and Marvel. And among them was an email called Female Movies from Perlmutter, where he cites films like Supergirl and Catwoman as proof that movies starring female superheroes are a terrible idea. That probably explains why Marvel has been so reluctant to make any movies starring lady leads, and why Captain Marvel was pretty much announced the instant Disney kicked Perlmutter out of the Marvel Studios. You know what they say, the arc of the Marvel Cinematic Universe is long, but it bends towards justice. Thanks for watching. Click the grunge icon to subscribe to our YouTube channel. Plus, check out all this cool stuff we know you'll love too.